has emerged as a notable world city. It embodies many of the features that define global cities at the dawn of the 21st century. These include a transnational flow of goods, people, and ideas, the rise of a diverse cosmopolitan culture, and a transient population. Indeed, all of these features make Miami what one urban geographer has called a paradigmatic city. Indeed, Miami is a model for what cities will look like both nationally and globally as we move through the 21st century. Yet, in places like Miami, when you have transience and a constant influx of people, you also find lack of attachment to place. In cities like Miami, residents' civic allegiances often are directed elsewhere. So a voter in Miami might be more interested in an election in her home country of Brazil, let's say, than in a congressional race here in South Florida. With lack of attachment to place, residents are less likely to participate in local civic, political, and cultural activities. So it should come as no surprise that Miami ranks extremely low in assessments of civic engagement when compared to metropolitan regions across the country. And it's not just Miami. The state of Florida also ranks extremely low in measures of political engagement for things like voter registration, contacting public officials, or attending a public meeting. And the data that's perhaps the most distressing is the statistic that Florida millennials are the least engaged age group in one of the least engaged states in the nation. So this data clearly paints a dire portrait of the state of our civic affairs in Miami and Florida as a whole. Yet the data doesn't tell the full story. The measures don't capture the variety of ways that political activity is happening and the many forms it is taking. Indeed, we are in the midst of a revolution in youth engagement and political activism. The very meaning of politics, the way we define it, is shifting, and youth are leading the way. Now, nothing better captures this transformation than the Oxford English Dictionary Word of the Year for 2017. That word was youthquake, a significant cultural, political, or social change arising from the actions or influences of young people. The term was first coined in the 1960s by Diana Vreeland, the editor of Vogue magazine, to refer to the role of young people in the cultural and political upheavals of that time. And much like youth in the 1960s, today's young people are claiming the political stage and transforming what counts as politics. The youngest generation, Gen Z, those born after 1997, are leading the way. And much of that activism is emanating from South Florida. So let me give you a few examples. In 2010, students from Miami walked 1,500 miles to Washington, D.C. to push for passage of the DREAM Act, which would grant legal status to undocumented immigrants who had been brought to this country as children. So what became a national movement actually had its roots right here in South Florida. In just the last year, after a rash of gun violence took the lives of children in the Liberty City neighborhood of Miami, students from Miami Northwestern High School staged a walkout to protest gun violence, reclaim their streets, and push for policies that would create safer communities. And perhaps the most visible example of local youth engagement came after the horrific February 14th school shooting at Marjorie Stoneman Douglas High School in Parkland. Those Parkland student survivors became household names across the country and around the world. They raised the visibility of the fight to end gun violence by coordinating worldwide school walkouts and also leading the March for Our Lives in Washington. And they made a difference in public policy. As a result of their activism, the first gun reform laws were passed in the state of Florida in over 20 years. So what's different about youth engagement today from that of the 1960s? Well, in addition to megaphones, today's youth activists are using their smartphones to get their message heard. Their engagement is digital. It happens in the streets, but also in online communities, and their message is dispersed through social media. Now, this young generation has gotten a lot of criticism for the extent to which they live their lives online. They are indeed the so-called selfie generation, and it does seem like much of their lives is captured online and mediated through social media. And researchers have also raised concerns about the impact of social media on the overall well-being of today's youth. Concerns over lack of privacy, increased loneliness, difficulty in forging close in-person relationships. And there's certainly skepticism about the extent to which liking a post on Facebook or retweeting a tweet should count as political engagement. Yet the digital world is changing what counts as politics in the 21st century. So all of the examples of youth activism I shared with you, the Dreamers, the Miami Northwestern students, and the Parkland survivors, all used various forms of social media like Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram to get the message heard. They amplified their voices in order to get young people engaged in pressing national issues like gun violence and immigration. And now they're also turning their attention to voter turnout. They're using the tools that resonate with young people in order to get the youngest generation involved in the political process. So the Parkland students, for example, launched the Road to Change voter registration drive. As part of that drive, they created this t-shirt with an American flag. But embedded within the American flag is a QR code. So if you scan it with your iPhone, you can register to vote immediately. Well, perhaps the best recent example of the impact of social media on political engagement is the recent post by Taylor Swift on Instagram. Just 2 days before the voter registration deadline, she posted a link to the website vote.org and encouraged her many, many followers to go and register. Well, in that 48-hour period, over 240,000 people registered to vote. That compares to just about 150,000 who had registered in the entire month of September. And of those who registered to vote in that 48-hour period, over half were between the ages of 18 and 29. So what makes social media so effective in promoting political engagement, and why is it impactful? Well, first, it erases geographic boundaries. So you now have access to people all over the world. It also enables new communities to form, so you can be part of an online community that you might not otherwise be exposed to. It's instantaneous. One post can reach millions of eyes in seconds. It also helps circulate information more broadly, not just among a small group of people. It disrupts hierarchies that traditionally have mediated engagement with politics. So you don't need a newspaper editor to have your op-ed approved or go through a political party to gain visibility. It is inexpensive and widely available. So these tools are available to a wide range of people. And it's mobile. Our smartphones go with us wherever we go throughout our lives, on the road and in the streets. Now, it's not just that there's new forms of politics that are emerging. There is actually something new that scholars like Daniel Allen at Harvard refer to as participatory politics. Participatory politics are interactive, peer-based acts through which individuals or groups exert both voice and influence on issues of public concern. They're not guided by deference to traditional elites and institutions. And they increasingly happen online. Indeed, today's youth organizers are using a variety of forms of activity to get their message heard. And research tells us that people who are involved in online communities of any kind are more likely to be exposed to politics, more likely to take part in political discussions online, and more likely to participate in politics and vote. The research also suggests then that rather than being dismissive of the impact of social media on political engagement, we should be conscious of its power to promote it. It also suggests that we might consider new measures of what counts as politics. So, sure, we want to know if people are visiting their elected official, writing op-eds, and voting. But we also might ask them if they are engaged in online activities connected to politics, if they are creating digital platforms to raise awareness of an issue, or if they are using social media to promote a cause. Because what we know is that all of these platforms are being used by today's youth. They're combining digital media with more traditional forms of political engagement. And as a result, a new form of leadership is emerging, one that is more dispersed, more democratic, and more diverse. So now, just a few days before the election, let's harness the passion of this new generation to reinvigorate the political process. Let's make a difference by getting to the polls and using the power of the ballot box to shape the future. But let's do more than vote. Let's embrace all the new tools that have become the hallmarks of this youngest generation. Digital media has opened up new spaces for where democracy happens. So let's use all the tools available to us to become engaged actors and shape a democratic public sphere that is more vibrant, inclusive, and civil. Thank you.